They say that the British cannot fix anything properly without a dinner, but I'm sure the Americans can fix nothing without a drink. If you meet, you drink. If you make acquaintance, you drink. If you close a bargain, you drink. They drink because it's hot. They drink because it's cold. If successful in elections, they drink and rejoice. If not, they drink and swear. They begin to drink early in the morning. They leave off late at night. They commence it early in life and they continue it until they soon drop into the grave. Captain Frederick Marriott.
For most of the nation's history, alcohol was at least as American as apple pie. The hold of the Mayflower, the ship that carried the first Puritans to Massachusetts, was filled with barrels of beer. At Valley Forge, George Washington did his best to make sure his men had half a cup of rum every day and half a cup of whiskey when the rum ran out. John Adams began each day with a tankard of hard cider. Thomas Jefferson collected fine French wines and dreamed of a day when American vineyards could match them. After Andrew Jackson's inauguration, so many drunken admirers crowded into the White House, the celebration had to be moved out onto the lawn to save the furniture. Young Abraham Lincoln sold whiskey by the barrel from his grocery store in New Salem, Illinois. Intoxicating liquor, he later remembered, was used by everybody, repudiated by nobody. A young Maryland slave named Frederick Douglass said whiskey made him feel like a president, self-assured and independent. Physicians recommended whiskey and cider and brandy and rum and beer as far better for their patients than water hauled from muddy rivers and stagnant pools. Clergymen drank, so did craftsmen and canal diggers, and the crowds of men who turned out for barn raisings and baptisms, funerals and elections, and public hangings.
It's part of ritual celebrations. It's part of being social. It's part of the gathering. And it's always been there. It just tells you something. Maybe we'll never really have an answer for why we need it. But if you look at the history, it's clear we do.
Americans routinely drank at every meal, including breakfast. In many towns, a bell rang twice a day to signal what was called grog time, so that men could stop whatever they were doing in factories and offices, mills and farm fields, to raise a jug.
In farm families in New England particularly, there was a barrel of cider by the door, and you came in and you would have your ladle of cider. Now, this wasn't as powerful as whiskey, but you know, it wasn't the kind of cider that we have with donuts today.
For thousands of years, human beings had been fermenting fruits and grains to create mildly intoxicating beverages. But by the 1800s, rum, whiskey, and other distilled spirits with significantly higher alcohol content had become increasingly available.
All of a sudden, you have all of these people growing grain, growing corn, growing oats, growing wheat, that can be distilled into whiskey. And so all of these rituals that had been part of the human experience, where farmers would get up and you would have beer with breakfast and beer with lunch and beer with your afternoon break and beer with dinner, but you're talking about 2% beer. But now all of a sudden people are drinking whiskey instead. And it took a while for the culture to recognize that, wait a minute, there's something really wrong here.
By 1830, the average American over 15 years of age drank the equivalent of 88 bottles of whiskey every year, three times as much as their 21st century descendants drink. Americans spent more money on alcohol each year than the total expenditures of the federal government. Inebriates filled the nation's poorhouses and workhouses and prisons. More and more, people began to worry that the country was becoming a nation of drunkards. And as the wages of many husbands and fathers and sons went to the grog shop, women and children became victims, mistreated, abandoned, deprived of food and shelter.
Alcohol consumption, at that point, was a sign of masculinity that took away masculinity. So that you drank to show that you were a man, but you get drunk and all of a sudden you can't provide for your family, you can't do your job, you become violent. There are so many references to the degradation of Saturday night. Implicit that a man would go out, first of all, he would leave the home, he would go to a saloon, he would get drunk, and he would come home and do whatever he wanted. This is a time when there is no divorce, when the concept of police protection for domestic violence doesn't exist, the concept of marital rape can't be discussed. But you can discuss it through alcoholism and what alcohol does to men.